stay down the chute. Never jump over the guardrails. That's kind of obvious. Go through the gates that they let you go through. Wireless robots must be operated by a tether when off the field, so you can't use them wirelessly when you're in the pits. But once you're on the playing field, wireless is okay. If wireless on practice fields, you have to use the first radio. Violations can be a verbal warning, or and it will be taken up by the referees, and the lead inspectors or event management. When you're climbing onto the airship, make sure you climb facing the airship one rung at a time, or you'll get yelled at. Simple stuff. Then our strategy, what we're going to do. We thought that we saw a lot of people were going for the gears, so we decided to go for the shooting the balls into the boiler. We'll make three trips to the boiler and try to shoot them into the top goal, the high efficiency area. And the processing time of the balls is. The fuel is 30 seconds. So for every trip, it's another 30 seconds of processing time. And then if we can't get all the, if we can't make the into the goal at least one out of three times, we'll go for the lower level and just get all the points we can get. We have two shooter prototypes at the moment. On the left.
Stop, wait. This is for the next part.
Okay.
Okay, I'm hoping someone can... Yeah.
I'm Brian.
So there are size restrictions. The maximum robot size, including bumpers and all extensions, must be contained into one of the two.
Can hear you back here.
One of the two restrictions. Oh. Awesome. So, hello. Okay. So it can either be 36 by 40 by 24 inches tall, or 30 inches by 32 and 36 inches tall. As you can see by the picture over there. The frame perimeter. The bot must have a frame perimeter that is contained within the bumper zone. So this is excluding the bumpers. So minor protrusions can be no greater than 1/4 of an inch. So this is including things such as like welds or etc. For the starting configuration, the robot cannot extend outside of the frame perimeter. And for acceptable motor limits, you are allowed a maximum of 6 SIM motors, and you're allowed to have unlimited use of non-restricted motors. And those are a list of acceptable motors. So, like, not a car engine, or, yeah.
Hi, my name is Brian Jacobs, and firstly I'll be talking about the weight limit. Now, simply, there is no exception. The weight limit is 120 pounds. I lied, there is an exception. It is the battery and the bumpers. Okay, so concerning the bumpers. Now, on the robot, the bumper corners must be covered with at least 6 inches, and that limits like the amount of open space you have, about at least 1 foot. So it could affect things such as ball intake and whatnot. And if a side is shorter than 6 inches, it must be covered with a bumper. Concerning the pneumatic components, no, pneumatic systems, pardon. The bare minimum you need is a compressor, a pressure relief valve, Nason pressure switch, at least one pressure unit, or vent, sorry, and a stored, as well as a working pressure gauge, and a pressure regulator. Now, on the robot, there are either two options. You can have the compressor on the robot or off the robot. However, it's a little more complex, and I won't exactly get into that. But, yeah, so that's concerning the basics of the pneumatic systems.
So, there's different pneumatic components that go into the systems, and all components must be remained in their original conditions, except a couple things. Like tubing can be cut and the wires can be modified, and there's some things about the mounting pins and labeling the device so you can indicate that it's yours or whatnot. And yeah, and then all the official rules, it gets more detailed as you look into it, but they're all found in the manual. So, and then for the operator console, it can be no longer than 60 inches and no deeper than 14 inches, and then it has to be 6 feet and 6 inches above the ground, so it can't exceed that height. So that's for like the sizes of where the person's controlling the robot. Yeah. So those are like the general basic rules about the robot.
Excellent. No, I think it's where. Yeah. We get the maximum number of switches, so.
Hi, my name is Will.
I'm Tommy.
I'm Lily.
And, it's gonna rip one up actually. So we decided to do shooting for a robot, like we kind of mentioned earlier when we overflowed a bit. First of all, can everybody hear me? Yeah? So we decided to do a shooter. This is our first prototype. It runs off of a wheel and a sim motor here, so the wheel will go inside. It actually broke when we were testing it because the 3D printed piece we're using to couple the wheel to the sim motor broke. But basically how it works is the wheel is inside here, and the ball will get dropped in, and I'll go around and I'll shoot out. And we have hit our target height with it, so we know it works. We just need to kind of not use plywood and kind of get our final design ready for that. We're using a tank drive for our drivetrain. It's just a kit that we got from FRC. We decided not to build our own drivetrain this year. We're kind of a rookie team since most of our teammates are new this year, so instead of just go with that.
For the climbing mechanism, so I haven't built a prototype yet, but I changed the design today after consulting our kind of engineering guy, and this design would have taken a lot of motors and a lot of torque. So I decided to kind of change that up a bit. It's still gonna have a cylinder sort of thing, but instead of separating and capturing the rope that way, it's gonna have like hooks, not sharp hooks, but like bag hooks on it. And it's gonna spin and it's gonna catch the knot in the rope. And once it kind of snags onto the knot in the rope, it'll start spinning. And as it rotates, the rope will start wrapping around it and eventually pull the robot up with it. And hopefully kind of stay in a vertical position uniformly on the rope and touch the touch pad at the top of the rope. But I'll be working on that prototype today since that kind of idea was made today.
One of the biggest reasons why we decided to work on the ball shooter as more of a focus for us is because it takes a lot more time to actually build it and get it as accurate of a shot as possible. While the gear mechanism itself, since you're only allowed to carry one gear at a time, if we wanted to add on a gear mechanism, we can just add it on as a passive, which means there's no mechanics to it at all at the very back of the robot, and it wouldn't take up that much space comparatively to the rest of the robot and any other thing we would have to add in, such as a hopper, a ball shooter, or as well as
The main reason why we did choose to do the shooter as our main mechanism was not just that, but we wanted to complement the bigger teams. Part of our strategy is to actually be kind of more useful for the bigger teams that would normally bring us into alliance. We want to be kind of appealing to them. So we think most of the bigger teams are going to do gears. So instead of doing gears and copying them, we will do balls so we can kind of stay out of their way, but we can still get them extra points, kind of, so we're a better alliance member that way.
Any questions?
Yeah, you know, this isn't our final wiring at all. It's just kind of something we did to test, so, yeah.
No questions?
My name is Julia Smith, and I'm from Kealakehe Tiki Techs, or FRC, Team 3880. I'll be going over the strategy in today's session. So at the beginning of this session, of this season, we went over a variety of different strategies, but we concluded that the strategy concerning gears as our highest priority would be the best way to go with the allotted time and point value per gear. We also looked into climbing and shooters as part of our strategy. In the first 15 seconds, the autonomous scoring, gears are the most prevalent value scored at 60 points per gear, and there's an opportunity to score around 120 points with all three gears mounted. Balls also count a lot in this part of the game, with three balls in the bottom scoring 1 kilopascal point and one ball in the top scoring 1 kilopascal point. This is important because later on in teleoperated period, this point value triples so that it goes to 3 balls in the top scoring 1 kilopascal point and nine balls in the bottom scoring 1 kilopascal point. another way that you could score in autonomous, which is would be fairly easy, would be to cross the border, and that's worth 5 points. in the teleoperated period, which is when the drivers take over, the gears are worth 40 points each, and if you happen to get all 12 of the gears on top, you would be able to get one ranking point or one ranking point in finals and 100 extra points in the pre-match. So the balls, as I've explained before, are worth 3 in the bottom and 9 in the top. Scoring 40 extra finals would earn you one ranking point, which is very important when it comes to actually placing. Climbing in the last 3 seconds of the match would give us 50 points, which is equal to 150 balls in the lower goal.
So just real quick, going over this, realizing part of the reason we're never scoring is just realizing what we're prioritizing. So gears are significantly more points than the balls. Getting two gears, to run the first rotor, it just requires one gear, which is 40 points, or the equivalent of 120 balls in high goal. So significantly more reward for the effort put in. So also noting the climb, as you said, it's 150 balls in the high goal for just one climb. So it's significantly easier to get points based on the gears and climb. However, we also get one ranking point if you get the 40 kilopascals for the balls. So we did want to create a shooter just for that extra ranking point during playoffs.
The subsystems that we are including on our robot this year would be our gear slot, a shooter, theoretically a ball intake, a hopper, and a climb.
Our gear system is designed to be passive, and in the front we have curved angled panels to guide the gear into our bot. And
try using the microphone. You have to turn it on.
So our gear system is designed to be passive, and in the front we have curved angled panels to guide the gear into our bot. And then this spot in front is open so that we can drive the gear onto the peg and it can be lifted out without us moving. And the gear rests at approximately 7 inches so that we can just jack up. Our first prototype was made of cardboard. And one of the main issues that we have was with the panels in the front and the gear slipping out between them. So in our improved prototype, we tested different sizes and shapes, and so this is what we have now.
Okay. So again, we're prioritizing the high goal and the shooter, particularly during the autonomous period where balls are worth 3 times as much. So every ball scored is worth 1 kilopascal points. So theoretically we could clear 1/4 of the required kilopascals to get the ranking point. So in terms of prototyping, we did FTC for the first time this year, and FTC also used a similar wiffle ball in their game. And what we found with that is that the double flywheel technique tends to be very erratic and go off side to side a lot, and probably was due to the fact of whenever we intake the ball, it was very, very particular about how far left and right it was in regards to the wheels. So what we decided to do is we went with a single flywheel with a hood. So as our current shooter design. And what it is, when we're prototyping, is we just use 1/8-inch plywood and we laser cut it. There's 3 rails that support the ball on either side, just to conform. So one of the problems we noted when we were prototyping is that the wiffles, the little holes, when unsupported in certain areas, the balls would create different rates of compression, which in turn would change how far and well we shot. So what we found is by increasing the number of support ramps on the base helped a lot. So anytime the wiffle or ball is touching one of the ramps, it's always supported in somewhere else, regardless of where the balls are. So our current goal right now is to create a turret shooter. And the reason for that is that beginning autonomous period is only 15 seconds long. And we do want to get the gear still on because that's worth 60 points compared to the 10 ball points. So in order for that to happen though, we'd need to be shooting while we're inputting the gear on, which requires shooting backwards with the turret while we're putting the gear. So next one. again, this is just our little shooter. Our final design we're planning to make up out of Delrin, because we found that we can laser cut things very well, and Delrin is a very strong plastic that works well in the laser cutter.
Okay. All right, so the climb. So at competition, where robots are going to need to climb a rope to reach a touch pad, which is about 4 feet and 10 inches off the ground. To do this, they need to climb a rope. And so the reason why we prioritize this is because the amount of points we get for the amount of time we need to invest into it is a lot better than shooting. So right here is worth 50 points, and that's equivalent to 150 balls in the high goal, right? So that's a lot of time spent trying to shoot into the high goal, plus the amount of time you need to take to intake the balls, be it on the field or the hopper. So that's a lot of time you need to spend gathering balls rather than actually scoring the points. So that's why we prioritize the climb. So in this prototype, we utilize a 775 Pro motor with a 1-100 gear ratio. And it's a fairly simple design. We have, it's just a simple lift with a reel with hooks on the attached to the reel. And so at competition, teams are allowed to bring their own ropes. So when we do bring our own rope, we're going to have a loop tied at the end of our rope in order for the hooks to catch. And then it's pretty simple after that. Once the reel rotates a few times, the robot will be climbing, and it'll hit the touch pad at the top of the rope. And then to keep it up there, we won't need to hold the motor. We'll just have a ratcheting system to keep it in place once the game is over. So drive training this year, it's a very, very open field. And what we decided with that is prioritizing pushing power and speed and acceleration over maneuverability. We think that there's definitely some maneuverability involved in placing gear on the peg, because you're trying to aim just a gear on a peg about this big. But just like realizing that in order to get the gears in the first place, we have to drive all the way across the field in order to intake them. So noting that, we went with a six-wheel West Coast drive system. Just very simple. We've made this drive before, and we decided that it'd be very well within our capacity, along with being able to make it very quick so we could concentrate on our other subsystems. Okay, and for the first time, we're using a hex drive base. So in competition, often robots are pinned with each other, and that's when a robot comes against the side. And that prevents us from turning and being able to maneuver ourselves. And that becomes a problem in competition. So with our hex drive base, we'll have an angle on the side of our robot that'll prevent robots from being perpendicular with our robot. So, and being at that angle, that'll allow us to turn in and out of a pin, so we won't be, our maneuverability won't be prevented by other teams.
So in the rules, they dictate that you can't be pinned against the wall. But what we found in a lot of pass games where there's open fields, if you have a very flat-sided bumper, teams can still actually pin you in the open field just by applying pressure on the side. So what our plan is, if you imagine an octagon or a hectagon with no real perpendicular panel in regards to the bot, they're always going to be pushing at an angle for us, and we will always be able to turn out of a pin. This is our bot.
Okay, so for programming, we decided. I'm Brock Taylor.
I'm David.
And we're gonna show you our programming and wiring. So for programming, we decided to use LabVIEW, which is a visual-based programming platform that's used all over the world by companies such as NASA. And it's even used to control the Large Hadron Collider. And we decided to use LabVIEW because although our programmers are experienced in other languages, it's much easier to read another team's LabVIEW code than it is their Java.
So for motor controllers, we decided to use Victor SPs and Talon SRXs. Talon SRXs are a bit more complicated than Victor SPs, so we are just using two on the drive and two on the shooter, and the rest are just Victor SPs, since they're much simpler to program. For sensors, we definitely want encoders on both our drive and our shooter. Also, we might want to use gyroscopes too for our drive, and vision sensors and sonar. What's that word? Ultrasound. Sensors. Ultrasonic. There we go.
So the big thing with the Talon SRX is that they have an integrated feedback loop for PID control of different motors. So what that means is for things like our shooter, where we're trying to keep a constant RPM, just so all of our bots are shooting at very consistently, we can directly hook up the shooter to the motor controller, and it just makes it a lot easier for programming. So we're pretty much using almost exclusively the Talon SRX just for the shooter and anything where we want to more control over the motor.
And also, unfortunately, the WPI library, which is kind of like the official library for LabVIEW, they don't currently don't support the CAN system, which is a major thing for Talon SRXs. So we had to find a different third-party system to download and get the functions that we need so we can work with our Talon SRXs.
Okay, so I'm Evan.
Oh, I'm Emily.
I'm Ezra.
And we were assigned with the subsystem of target shooting and onboard image processing. And the idea behind this is because obviously scoring in the high goal is way more important and more valuable than scoring in the low goal. But it's also much more challenging. And so the idea is to set up a camera which automatically processes where you need to arrange yourself in order to score. And part of that process, or our setup, we have a camera with an LED ring, and the LED is very bright green, and around the target, there's retroreflective tape, which reflects the green. And with the camera connected to our Raspberry Pi, and using the program we have, we're able to communicate back to the driver station and show the driver exactly where we need to move ourselves and set the motors in order to score.
Okay, so I think Ian explained it earlier. So the reason that we want the vision tracking for the shooter is because for our autonomous, we need to be able to score balls while also doing a gear. So that's what the turret system will do, and that's what this program will do. So we actually wrote this in program. Shout out to Larry. He's pretty cool. He helped us write this. So this picture on my right is a picture of the code that we have right now. It's the most recent one. So what this program will do when it's run, it'll take a video and it'll analyze the frames, and then it'll look for the brightest area of light. And then from that, it'll tell us to move that bright light into the center of our camera and tell us to shoot there.
So right here is a diagram of a custom circuit that we put together to interface with the Raspberry Pi itself. So this is going to do a couple of things. A side function that it has is it's good for testing because it has LEDs on it. So we can have the green LED light up when our robot is aligned with the target, or our shooter is aligned with the target, sorry. And then the two red ones on either side will tell us in what direction we need to go in order to get the shooter to be lined up with the target. So the main function of this board is to allow this, which is an ultrasonic rangefinder, which we were talking about earlier, to communicate with our Raspberry Pi. So that will let us, because we can tell in what direction we need to turn in order to face the target, but in order to know how far we need to shoot, we need to know how far away from the target we are. Because like if you're right in front of it versus all the way across the field, it can be right in front of you and you'll still miss unless you know how far away from it you are, so that you'll know how far you need your shooter to shoot or to move to get there or whatever we decide to do. And so one of our main challenges that this board will also be useful for, because this is just a
prototyping board, is getting our Raspberry Pi to communicate with the RoboRio itself. So this is the RoboRio, and it contains all the code that he was talking about earlier that actually controls the robot itself. So we're going to have to be able to get this Python code, which is running off of this Raspberry Pi, to communicate with the RoboRio in order to tell the robot where to go.
The RoboRio runs LabVIEW, I think that was mentioned earlier. But they're two different programs, and that's why we're having an issue of seeing how they can communicate.
So that was just a kind of quick cat of our end product and goal. So if you can kind of see, we only have about a 5-degree angle in our hex bumpers. Again, that's to help with defense and getting pinned. We're planning to have the shooter on the opposite side of the robot and then shooting the opposite direction of where we're placing the gear. That way, looking at the airship, while we're placing the gear on, we can also shoot into the high goal simultaneously. Oh. And the whole thing is a hopper, basically, for all the balls. And I think that's it. So, any questions?
What is doing the climbing? Is it the whole robot?
Yeah, so essentially there's a rope hanging down from a little pad. You have to touch the pad for 1 second at the end of the game. Remembering that you can't extend out of your frame perimeter, which means that you just have to climb the rope in order to touch the touch pad.
That's 120 pounds,
yeah.
You need to lift.
Yeah.
Well, you really weigh 120 pounds.
So it's going to probably be, I think, like 140 pounds with the bumper and battery. Again, that's a 775 Pro on a 100-to-1 gear ratio, so it really creeps its way up.
So I like to eat Raspberry Pi. Maybe you could give a little more explanation of your Raspberry Pi, which I don't think I want to eat.
So it's this thing right here, this is a thing, and it's a custom circuit board. I don't actually know why it's a custom circuit board. It's basically just not stacking me up on high. It may not actually, the company may not actually be called Raspberry Pi, but regardless, so it runs a Linux operating system that we got to have. It's basically a Python environment that allows us to run the code that we write in Python, and it's just a little, it has too many computers, so it has memory, and it has a processor to process all the information that we tell it to process, and then these are just input out things where it gets data. And we have these connected over to our proto board, and this is where all the sensors and stuff.
So going back to image processing real quick, the bigger idea is that in order to have image processing to their autonomous period where we can't control where we're shooting, we can't do off-board image processing where we'd send video back to the laptop just because the bandwidth would be too much for us to process. So what we have to do is we have to take the video imaging from the robot on the field and do the onboard image processing through the Raspberry Pi. So we're never actually bringing that video back to the laptop. We're doing all the image processing on board, and then the data just gets sent back to the laptop. If that clarifies. Anything else?
What's your game plan for bringing the Python code and the code for the robot together? What's the plan for the interface?
We're going to have the... should I go out there?
Yeah. Ideally.
So we're going to have... Larry's helping us do this right now, but we're going to be creating a part of a program that will run on this to emulate... the signal that a normal PWM sensor would give. So this RoboRio can take data from lots of different kinds of sensors that this robot can handle. And so we weren't quite sure how to like actually make Python communicate directly with LabVIEW. So we decided, it's a little bit of a hack, but we decided that we're just going to make our data be transmitted through PWM as if it was just some sensor, like an encoder or any kind of sensor. And then we'll have our LabVIEW team, we'll tell them, like, this is what this means, this is what that means, and then they'll be able to use that to tell the robot where to go.
I want to add that Ezra came up with that model. I was coming up with a very complex thing about writing the Python code and LabVIEW code, maybe some low-level software, and Ezra was like, well, what if we just create it like a PWM sensor? So And, you know, and it was like, oh, yeah, yeah, let's do that.
For both teams, I presume that the actual shooting is operator controlled.
Yes.
The aiming and the release.
So that's more especially critical for the autonomous period. Yeah. The shooting, the onboard image processing.
How large is the physical field you're dealing with?
Its dimensions? 60 by 20 or?
100 by 50.
100 by 50? No, it's not that big.
You won't have an opportunity to practice on a real field.
Unfortunately not, but we can drive around on our library carpet.
It's not unusual to set up taped out areas in a parking lot or something in order to get the drivers a feel for what space they have.
So what we did do is we built a lot of the game pieces. So like the gear loading mechanism that drops the gears into the field, we built that, and we also built the boiler, which is what we're shooting at. So
we do try and simulate as best we can the features of the game in order to test the robot as good as we can.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much.